Alright, welcome back. So in the last video, we had finished the Blogify thing, and now, like I said, we had to finish two more things. First was version control, and next was deploying, right? So in this video, we are going to start with the version control, and basically the topic will be Git and GitHub, right? So this is basically that something that I have used throughout the course without you knowing it, because I had to keep track of different stages of my code. Right. So I'll explain exactly what they are, but first of all, let's first list out what the uses of these two are, right? First is version control, right? So version control is something that you might not have paid a lot of attention to until now. And why is that? Because you just started doing something and it was like simple CRUD procedures in Blogify, especially. Like, I didn't follow version control in anything else. I followed version control in Blogify, but like not proper version control, but you'll see what I'm talking about. But I've like managed stages that at this stage I have done things until this, right? So I have managed kind of stages. And if you're like unaware of the term version, so version is basically that version one would be like the initial release of your app, right? Let's say. And then you make some changes, you make some really big additions, and then you move to version 2, right? So that would be version control. And one thing you could do is like that. You need to keep a track of all versions, right? So you might have to revert back to version 1 at some point, and you do need access to the version 1 code at all points of time, even if you have moved to version 3, right? So that is what Git can help you with. And plus, you can make multiple like checkpoints inside your single version that I have completed this until here and I have completed this until here. So how that helps you in a big app is that, like in Blogify, we had only the CRUD procedures, but let's say you are making something really, really big. So then you will be adding very complex features all the time. You will be adding complex things all the time, right? So then, like, what happens is, let's say you made something, you are at like 70% of your app is done, and then you make a very major change and you try to add a feature, but what happens is you do something wrong in that and your whole app crashes, right? So now you want to revert back to when you had done only 70% so that you can try that feature again. So how will you do that if you are not saving your progress, right? You will have to delete everything you did in the latest thing, and you will have to like remember each and every line that you wrote. You'll have to go manually. You'll have to press backspace on that. You'll have to remove all the lines, and then you'll have to start all over again, right? So that of course cannot be a really good solution. So let's say you have, so when you're making a big, like big project, you might have 10 files that you might be able, let's say you have 3 files that you are editing at one time to add a feature, right? And you add like 1,000 lines. So removing 1,000 lines from 3 files is definitely not a good solution, right? So what Git can help you do is that it can help you make that 70%, that when you had completed 70% and everything was working fine, it can help you make that a checkpoint. And after that, you do whatever you want and you run into a bug. And then you can just simply tell Git, I want to revert back to this particular checkpoint, right? And in that way, you will be able to do that in just one command through the terminal, and it will be no issue at all, right? So that's what version control basically is. And when we like see Git and GitHub, I'll explain even more how this can be useful. Because if you have never developed a very big thing until now, or if I'm not just talking about web development, if you've like coded for anything in any language until today, and you have made something big and complex, you will know that it is possible that your app is working at some point and then you add a feature and then your app crashes, right? So Git can be really helpful in that. We'll see more of this later. Code sharing, right? So a lot of the times you will be working alone on a project, and a lot of the times you will be working with a team, right? So let's say it's a 5-person team, a 6-person team. Then let's say all 6 of you are working on different features. So how will you share code amongst yourselves, right? Will you like, every time you add a feature, will you mail them your whole code file? Of course not, right? So for that, you can use GitHub. And up until now, you might remember I've put up a code sharing link in the description in every video, right? So that actually was GitHub. So it can, like, GitHub is something that can help you in code sharing a lot, and that is GitHub is actually just the UI version of Git. So Git works through your terminal, and GitHub works as a GUI, right? You can use it with your mouse, right? GitHub is a GitHub site. I'll open a incognito window so that we can see GitHub without getting logged in. And now I'm going to use GoorMyD for this particular thing. And the reason behind that is I had a lot of Git and GitHub set up already in my personal computer, and I did not want you to get confused that how is this happening when we've not even done it. So we'll do everything from scratch, right? So this is GitHub, basically. This is what GitHub is. And we'll move into this. We'll make new accounts on this, but let's say we go to this link, right? I'm currently not logged in, remember that, right? So you can see I have all of my code here, and I have everything that I could need in here, and then I can just go to here and I can open anything that I want, right? So the point is, all of this I wasn't copying and pasting all the time in here, right? What I did was I wrote a simple command on my terminal, and all of it went to GitHub, right? And now I am seeing it from here. I updated it 40 minutes ago, you can see that, right? So I updated 40 minutes ago from my computer, but now I'm accessing it through an incognito tab, meaning I'm not logged in, so I'm not in my current ID, but still I will get the same code. So that's how GitHub works. I mean, there are a lot of things to GitHub that you will get to know in this in the next one or two videos. But for now, you can see that everybody has access to the same code real time, right? So if I put some code on GitHub, then one of my friends can see the code from here too. And there are a lot of things you can do with GitHub, right? We'll see that. So code sharing is the next reason. And the last is code backup, right? So I have my code here, and let's say in the future, due to some weird error, my laptop gets, something happens to it, and I lose access to all the files. One, like, how will I work then, first of all, right? So first of all, I lose access to my working machine. So if like my code is uploaded somewhere, so GitHub is an online site, is a cloud-based site. It does not depend on my laptop. Once this code is here, it is here, no matter what I do. I can choose to delete it from here if I want to, but if my laptop gets formatted due to some reason, this code will still persist here, right? So basically I have a backup of my code everywhere. And next, even if my laptop like breaks down permanently and I don't have my code here, then I'll be losing all my project files that I've completed, and that's not something we want, right? So code backup is the last feature that we could need. Now sharing and backup you could also like do through some other sites. I'm sure there are other sites for this, but let me tell you, GitHub is inarguably the most popular site. I think more than 99% of developers would be using GitHub for code sharing. I actually don't even know any other site for code sharing, right? So GitHub is the thing for code sharing, because as you will see, it has loads and loads of features, right, which are very useful for developers. So this is like an overview of the whole thing and the use. So the one thing is Git versus GitHub. So actually this title is very misleading. It's not which is better. We can't tell whether Git is better or GitHub is better, because they're actually the same thing, right? So what the point is that Git is actually like, it can work without GitHub. Git is not dependent on GitHub, but GitHub is like an online version, a version which you can use with your mouse of Git itself. Git is not a website that you can use like this. It is some commands that you will run through the terminal that will help you keep your version control, right? So Git can actually work without GitHub, and that's the whole point of this whole slide. So don't get misled by this title. This is just something that I put here. And Git is basically on your local machine, and GitHub is cloud-based, right? So that's the difference. Anyway, so now let's start seeing some demo. So first, what we're going to see is we're going to see Git, and the next we're going to see GitHub, because if you know Git, then you'll be able to understand GitHub much better. Right. All right. So I've made a new container in my Goom ID because this is the Git demo container, right? And I could also use this one, but Git is already initialized and everything is done inside this one. So I'll not take this one and I'll run this new container. You can choose to run your old container too because you do not have Git currently set up in this. But I'll suggest that you make a new one so that you can replicate exactly what I'm doing, right? So let's let it open up really quick. Great. So I have my workspace open here and I have currently only the main.js here, right? And it says hello Goom if I run it. So I can do what I'm doing here. And just in case you are thinking which configuration settings I use to make this container, they are the same as this one. You can see the stack is Node.js. I also installed Mongo, even though we will not be needing it in this, but I did install it, right? And then I've just left everything as it is. This was actually what we did in the web dev course container too, right? So now I have this file here, and let's say I add so currently, let's say I don't add anything. This is just my code. Even though this is like a really simple code, but the point is we need to see version control. So now I want to see Git in it. Git, how to use Git, right? So Git is actually a command line tool that you need. So if I type Git here, I'm getting a lot of things, which you will get too if you are using Goom. So it's not a problem if you're getting all of these. Means your Git is installed. But if you're working on like a Windows laptop or something, I think Mac comes pre-installed with Git, so you don't need to worry about it. Just run this command once, and if you don't get something like did not find this command and you got something like this, then you are good to go, right? Otherwise, you can go online and you can just search for download Git. And you can see this is like the first or the first link, and you can select your OS here, it will be your OS here, whatever it is, and you can download it, right? So, and then when you do this, means your Git is installed, right? So the next thing, now our Git is installed, but we want to start our version control from it, right? So if we summarize what Git does, it basically tracks your files, right? It tracks your files, it keeps a track of what you have changed, it keeps a track of what all you already had, it keeps a track of what file you added, what you deleted, and it just, you know, it is like a monitor of your files, right? But the so that is how it will actually do version control too, as we see. But the thing is, Git does not automatically monitor everything on your computer, right? And obviously you do not want it to do that. We don't want to use Git with everything. So it will not monitor your this thing until you specifically tell it, right? What I mean is, whenever we are starting running Git, we have to run this one command, which is called git init. And it'll say initialize empty git repository in workspace git demo.git. And you will see now we have a .git folder here. And this is actually everything that we do related to Git will be stored in here. And I've just opened it, and this is the first and the last time we are going to open it. You never need to open the .git folder. I mean, you can, but it's no use, right? So by doing the git init, what we just did is we told Git to start tracking this particular directory because we are in the git demo in the terminal. So we told Git that, okay, start tracking this particular folder and start tracking all the changes that I'm making in here, right? So that's what you did with this git init command, right? So now I'm just going to simply run over the basic git commands that you have, and I'll introduce the use of each of them. And that's basically all the use of git that you should know by heart, right? Actually, there are a lot of things that you might want to do with git, but the thing is, it is so complex that apart from just these basic commands, if you ever want to do anything, you'll just go here, you'll search for that thing and you'll do it, right? None of the developers remember the whole Git by heart, right? You just know the basic commands. So I'll make like a cycle of how Git works, right? So the commands work, right? The first is git status, and we'll run this command, these commands after this, and we'll see their use, right? So let's make a good looking table here. Right, git add, and then the next thing is git status again. I mean, this is a step that a lot of developers, once you are comfortable with git, you will choose to skip, but it doesn't matter. As a beginner, you should focus on this step too. Right, and next we have and great. Then we can have this, right? All right, so then the last command that you have is basically git commit, right? And then you will move back up to here. And I don't think that, okay, here it is. So this is the cycle that you will be following, and one cycle will track one set of changes that you make, right? So when you complete the cycle one time, you will be completing your one checkpoint, as I said in the introduction. So these four steps once gives you a checkpoint, then you do what these four steps again when you might want to make a checkpoint, and so on and so forth, right? So let's see the use one by one. Git status, right? So now when I do git status, it tells me on branch master. Ignore this for now. Branches we'll see in just a moment. No commits yet, right? So the commit word, it looks familiar, but we don't know what that is. Leave that too. We'll see that in just a moment. The main thing that you always have a look at whenever you do git status, these two you don't like pay a lot of heed to most of the times, is this, right? So what exactly is this? So it is saying untracked files, right? Gurb.manifest main.js. So what this basically does is, whenever you add a file, whenever you delete a file, whenever you edit a file, then it will come here. So basically currently there are no checkpoints, but you can imagine the initialization of git to be the zeroth checkpoint, right? And so when we are adding the first checkpoint, it notices that these are the things that are not currently added to my git checkpoint, right? These were not present in my very first git init. So even though main.js was present, git init just makes this folder. It does not start tracking anything inside, right? So it just tells me that these two files are new and they have not currently been added to your checkpoint, right? And that's basically all that status does. That if we made another file and we did git status again, we'll do that in just a moment. Then you will see that the name of that other file here too. And if main.js is already added in a checkpoint, then it will not show up in the next one, right? So we'll see this in more, you'll get a better idea when we actually see an example. When we are making our second checkpoint, currently we are making our first, right? So this is basically what git status does. Then what we can do is git add, right? So what add does is, currently you see it's saying untracked files. So what this means is that these files are currently not added to the list which you want to add in the checkpoint. So what you can do is, you can choose that if you change five files, you want to like save only three in the checkpoint and two you want do not want to save, right? So just to give you, and you'll get this better when we get to git commit, but what git add does is, it tells us what all files we need to update when we are doing the checkpoint, right? So basically you can do git add and then you can write the main name of your file, right? If I do git add main.js, it does not show anything happened, but then I can do git status again, which is the third step as you see there, right? And you can see changes to be committed, new file main.js, untracked files gurm.manifest, right? So it says that these files are now being tracked. And whenever you make your next checkpoint, this change will be saved in there, right? So this is what git add basically does, right? And you can perform git adds many times. So this is the thing that you would do, but like you can keep on moving between these two as much as you want, right? You can do git add goon.manifest again, and then there's no problem. You can do status again, right? And you see that the two new files have been done to changes to be committed, right? So this is something that you can do, and then you can do git status again to see that, okay, my files have been added to my commit list. And the last step you do is you make a commit, right? So what a commit basically is a checkpoint. So checkpoint is what we are calling it in our English language, and a commit is something that we will call it in development language, right? So I'm saying that this is a checkpoint and everything is saved in this checkpoint. Git says that this is a commit and everything is saved in this particular commit, right? So let's make a commit and then you'll get a better idea. So every commit has a message, right? So you can imagine that if you are on a checkpoint, then you put a label on it saying that I added login and logout functionality here, right? So, and that it will be saved with that checkpoint so that in the future, you can come back and see, okay, this is where I added my login and logout functionality, right? So we actually need to give that commit message. So the syntax of git commit is basically git commit as it is. Then you write dash m and then you put your message, meaning inside quotes. So everything you write inside quotes will be your commit message, meaning if you are adding something and you want the label to be added login and logout routes, then you want to put that exact text inside of it. So let's say I am doing initial commit and I press enter. So it gives me an error, right? So this is actually something that we will do most of the time, but there's one more thing that we actually need to do, right? So we like actually need to tell git who we actually are, as it says, please tell me who you are. And we'll have to run this exact command, right? So do not worry about what this command is. Even I don't remember this command. All I do is I copy this, I paste this, and they're saying run this, right? So they're like, just do whatever we are telling you to do, and you can do that. So I think I've copied an extra space. Yes, I have. And the user email I'll make. Right. So now I've told git that this is my email, and that's basically all that we need to do. And we can do that commit statement now, right? And you can see it tells me initial commit, two files changed, six insertions, which is basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? And basically you can ignore what this is because you won't actually pay heed to this a lot. What you will be doing is that you'll not even see this. If you're getting a message like this, means your checkpoint has been created, right? And you can see it saying create mode goon.manifest, create mode main.js. And it means that these files have now been tracked. And if I do git status again, and it says nothing to commit, working tree clean, meaning all the changes that I have made currently in my directory have already been saved in a commit. So here we have made a checkpoint, and in the future, if we ever want to come back to this checkpoint, we can do that really easily with one or two more commands, which we'll see later, right? So coming back then, so now this is saved forever, and no matter how many more commits we make, we can always come back to this one, right? All right, so now let's do some changes and then make another commit, right? So I'll do touch fruits.js, touch applications.js. So I made two new files, and let's say I made some changes in them, and let's say I just did. And I saved this. I saved my main.js too. Currently, you can see these changes were not saved. So now my main.js has been edited too, right? And I'll go into my fruits.js. I'll copy this line. I'll paste it in here. So I'm just putting some content in here. It doesn't matter what I'm putting in, right? You could have anything in here. So now I've made some changes, and let's do git status again. You can see it says changes not staged for commit, modified main.js. Why? Because this change was not saved in the last commit.
And hence, this was not committed in our checkpoint, right? So it says you have modified main.js and you have added these two new files, right? So what we can do is we can do git add, and then basically you want to add these three, right? So you could like write their names separately, or you could just simply write dot, right? And what dot does is it adds everything that you have in the change. Then you can do git status, and you see it says changes to be committed, new file application.js, new file fruits.js, modified main.js. And then you can just simply do git commit dash m, and let's say add fruits, and this message can be anything that you want. This could be any random string of numbers too, right? Doesn't matter. But the thing is that if you're making some commits and you're making checkpoints and you actually want to come back to them, it's obviously logical to have some meaningful commits, right? And I click on this and my commit has been made, right? So now if I check git status again, there's nothing to be changed. And one thing that you notice that there was no gurm manifest in here, right? So that is actually a gurm file that we're not even seeing here. But the thing is, it was not here, even though it was there in the first commit. And why is that? Because nothing had changed in the gurm manifest after the first commit. And if we like add another file, and now if I do git status, I see only new.js has been shown here, and the files that have not been changed after the previous commit do not show up in my untracked files, right? So now I can do git add dot, and like you can see I was directly doing commit because I'm used to it, but you can check that it has been added correctly. And if you're doing git add dot and you're not getting an error, then it is added correctly. There is no doubt in that. But just to check in the starting and to be sure, you can do git status again. And then I do git commit dash m add new.js file. And you can see my commit has been made. So now I had three commits, and let's say I want to go back to one of them, right? So what I can do is, first of all, to get a check of what all my commits have been, I can do git log, and you can see it tells me commit something something something. This is an ID that git has given it, and it says add new.js file, which is the commit message that I gave, and it says this commit something something is add fruits and applications, which was the previous commit that I made. And then you cannot traverse this by your normal scrolling of the mouse, right? You cannot go down. What you need to do is you need to press the down arrow, right? And you can see the first commit is initial commit and there's nothing below it. So this is the list of commits that I have, and this is basically all the checkpoints that I've made, right? And this is how you would do it. So first of all, to exit this, you can just type Q and it will exit you out of this, right? And then let's do git log again, and let's try to go back to this commit when we did not have this new.js file, right? So what you need to do for that is you need to copy this whole thing that they've written here, right? Just copy this weird string, press Q, and then type git checkout, and then paste that in, right? So checkout is the command that after this you will put your commit, this weird ID, and then if you press enter, it tells you you are in the detached here state, blah blah blah, checking out this commit. If you want to create a new branch, forget about branches. What I wanted to see is on the left we don't have a new.js file, because now we have moved to the version where we did not actually make that file, right? And this is basically all that there is in git, basically, right? So there's a lot of things, but this is the basics. And yeah, so this is all that you need to actually know in this, right? And then if you like want to go back to where your current state was, you can even do that. You can do git checkout master. I'll tell you what master is. And now you can see my new.js is back. Master is basically, for now you can say that this is the latest version of your app, right? And yeah, so this was a basic intro to the commands of git. I'll recommend that you do this like 7-8 more commits by yourself. Just see this thing and run these commands, and eventually you'll get used to it. And these are basically the only commands that you need to get used to. all the other things, like the config command that we saw there, you can run on your own. And one thing that I did not say, I think, that just copy this whole thing and put your email in there, right? And it will not ask you for anything else. So now we have added Git in our application, and this way you can like add any number of files to Git, and then you can just use them, right? So this was all about Git that we're going to see in this course, and like we'll see branches and one more thing. So okay, let's just do that in this video. So I'll not dive very deep into how you make branches through Git, because that will take some amount of time. But let me tell you what a branch is. So a branch is actually exactly what you think it is. That branches, if you think of a tree, they are like, let's try to make something here. This is a tree trunk, and then there are like branches extending from it. So we'll be making perfect branches here, like completely straight, even though they're not completely straight ever, but we'll make it, right? And I'll add my branch here too. So let's say this is one branch, and okay, so we'll just work with two branches right now. Right. So these are the two branches of the tree, and like this is what you could like see this. This is a like this is horizontal tree. You need to make it vertical to actually get an example of the real life tree. But I'm making it according to Git, right? So this is something similar to what you can do. So this is basically the master branch, right? What's running in between is the master branch, and this is the branch that has all your main code, which has been completely tested and which is to be launched into the market, right? This is your main code. And let's say you want to add a new feature. So what you can do is you make a new branch. Now, when you are making the branch at this point of time, then it has all the code that was present in master at this particular point, right? It has all the code in there. And then what you can do is you can start making your changes in this file, and you can, let's say you make a lot of changes and you do, and then you just right, so let's say you are moving forward with these changes. And at the same time, your master is also moving forward. Right? So the thing is that the changes you are making here are not currently reflected in master. So even if you make some bug here, that will not be reflected in the running version of your code, which is launched into the market currently, and you're like making a new feature for the next version, it will not be reflected in your code, right? And what you can choose to do later is that you can merge this branch back, and let's say you merge this branch back here. So this is what merging would look like. I'm trying my best to make a tree here, but all right. Right. So what happens is, once you check this for errors, once your testing is complete, you just merge this back into master, and then at this point, when this is merged back, your master gets all the changes that you made in this particular branch, right? So that is basically all what branching is, right? And like you could search Google for branching Git tutorial, and I'm sure you'll get a lot of good things in here, right? Managing branches, and you can see they like give you a really good article. The Git, this is like the Git official website, I think. Yeah, and they'll give you good commands. So this is the command that you need to make a branch. This is one to check your branch, and so on. So now basically what you saw is that you made your changes and you merged them back into master, and whatever changes were made in master are still retained, like in this span of time. Whatever changes were made, they are still retained, and even these changes are put back into it. So now this is a stable version and this has all the features that you want it to have, right? So this was an introduction to branch, and now I'll recommend that you do read this article on the main page. You would like probably leave the conflicts thing, basic merge conflicts and merging, right? So try to read up to here and read the commands to try them out on your branch, on this git, right? And then you'll get clear on what branching is. This was just like a basic intro. And yeah, so this was all about git that we needed to know and that you'll ever need to know, right? If you need something new, you'll just Google, you'll paste that command in your terminal and you'll run it. You won't even try to understand what it's exactly doing. But that's all you'll ever need to know. And in the next video, we'll take a look at GitHub. And we'll see how GitHub implements all of these, what we just did through our terminal, in a user interface, right? You can see they have branch here. You can add a branch, view all branches. You can see it says committed this 1 hour ago. So I've added some commits. You can say this is a commit message, adding to blogify intro 12 days ago, add arrays code last month, video error workaround 4 days ago, and so on, right? Add functions exercise last month. So you can see I've made a lot of commits here. You can see I have 32 commits and they have been made at different points of time and the whole thing has been made correctly. So we'll take a deeper look at this in the next video and we'll stop here for this one. So I'll see you then.